Welcome to the Equal Opportunities Committee, the 19th meeting of 2014. Can I ask everyone to set off any electronic devices to flight mode or switch off, please? I'd like to start with introductions. We're supported at the table by the clerking and research staff, official reporters and broadcasting services, and around the room by the security office. And welcome to the observers in the public gallery. My name is Margaret McCullough and I'm the committee's convener. And members will now introduce themselves in turn, starting here on my right.
I'm Marco Biaggi, I'm the MSP for Edinburgh Central, a deputy convener of the committee. Good morning.
Morning, Siobhan McMahon, MSP Central Scotland.
Good morning, Christian Allard, MSP for North East Scotland.
And morning, John Finney, MSP Highlands and Isles.
Alec Johnston, member for North East Scotland.
John Mason, MSP for Glasgow Shettleston.
Thank you very much. The first agenda item today is taking a decision in private. You're asked to agree consideration of your approach to your budget, to your report on the draft budget for 2015-2016 at item 7 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you. Agenda item 2 is also a decision of taking business in private. You're asked to agree consideration of your approach to an inquiry into age and social isolation in private at future meetings. Are we all agreed? Agenda item 3 is to hear evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Wellbeing in two affirmative instruments, namely the Marriage Between Civil Partners, Procedure for Change and Fees, Scotland, Regulations 2014 draft, and the marriage, same-sex couples, due restriction and the recognition of judgments, Scotland, Regulations 2014 draft. These instruments are laid under the affirmative procedure, which means the Parliament must approve it before the provisions may come into force. Following this evidence taken, the committee will be invited to consider motions to approve the instruments under agenda item 4. I welcome the Cabinet Secretary and his accompanying officials. Can I ask you to introduce yourselves, and I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make any opening remarks.
Thank you very much indeed, the convener. I'll let the team introduce themselves and then I'll make some opening remarks. Cecilia.
I'm Cecilia McCulloch from the Scottish Government Legal Directorate.
I'm Simon Stockwell. I'm head of the property law team in the Scottish Government.
Good morning. My name is Julia McCombie, family and property law team in the Scottish Government.
Kate. Thank you. These two statutory instruments relate to the introduction of same-sex marriage in Scotland. The first one is on changing civil partnerships into marriages. The Marriage and Civil Partnerships Scotland Act 2014 contains two ways for persons in a civil partnership registered in Scotland to change their relationship into a marriage. Section 8 allows couples to make the change through a marriage ceremony. The alternative is an administrative route laid down by regulations made under Section 10. These are the regulations we are discussing today, the Marriage Between Civil Partners Procedure for Charge and Fees Scotland Regulations 2014. The regulations provide that couples in a qualifying civil partnership will be able to apply to any district registrar in Scotland to make the change. Those couples are first of all couples who have registered the civil partnership in Scotland, and secondly couples who have registered the civil partnership through UK consuls or UK armed forces overseas and elected Scotland as a relevant part of the United Kingdom. Couples must present together in the registration district where they want their marriage to be registered and provide an application form completed but not yet signed, the civil partnership extract, the certificate, and any forms of identification requested by the district registrar. The registrar general will provide guidance to registrars on what type of identification will be acceptable. The district registrar will change the civil partnership into a marriage if satisfied with the information provided. For couples who registered the civil partnership before same-sex marriage is available in Scotland, the change into marriage through the administrative route will be free for the first year. Should the couple wish to receive a marriage certificate, there will be a £10 fee for each certificate in line with the usual charge in Scotland for such certificates. The other SSI is on the jurisdiction of the courts. The Marriage Same-Sex Couples Jurisdiction and Recognition of Judgment Scotland Regulations 2014 make provision on 1. when Scottish courts have jurisdiction in relation to proceedings for divorce, separation and nullity of marriage. 2, when Scottish courts have jurisdiction in relation to proceedings on the recognition of decrees from out with the EU concerning such matters. And 3, the Scottish courts recognising judgments from elsewhere in the EU on matters such as divorce, separation and nullity of marriage. They follow similar regulations made at the time civil partnerships were introduced. The regulations make provisions similar to that contained in EU Regulation 2201/2003, commonly known as Brussels 2A. This deals with court jurisdiction and the mutual recognition of judgments in relation to matrimonial matters within most EU member states. It is generally accepted that Brussels 2A does not extend to cases involving same-sex couples, which is why we need to make these regulations, and I'm happy to take any questions on both of them. Convener.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Christian, I think you would like to start asking questions.
Yes, thank you very much, Convener. Yes, Cabinet Secretary, just a small question, maybe a point of details. It's regarding the possibility of fraud. I think the Faculty of Advocates expressed some concern regarding the problem of application that can be made with any form of identifications, that it would maybe more suitable that we you would design what kind of form of identification that would be required.
The sort of possibility of fraud, really, yeah. I think is what you're saying. We actually think the possibility of fraud is absolutely minimal because couples may apply to any district registrar. However, all registration offices in Scotland have access to the details of registrations made in other districts. Furthermore, National Records of Scotland will be producing guidance for registrars on accepted forms of identification. After discussion with registrars, we thought it best to lay down in guidance rather than prescribing the regulations what forms of ID would be acceptable. We felt that being too prescriptive in this area could negatively impact on an applicant who does not have exactly the correct prescribed form of ID, but could present an equivalent document. We don't want people to be unable to make the change simply on the basis of not having exactly the right form of ID. In addition, the chance of fraud is minimised because both applicants are required to attend together to sign the application form before the district registrar when making the change from civil partnership to marriage. And finally, the regulations contain provisions creating a criminal offence for any person who falsifies or forges the application form. So I think we've covered all the different ways in which somebody might try to defraud the system, but we actually think the possibility of fraud is very, very minimal indeed.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. John Finney.
Morning, Cabinet Secretary. Not specifically on this, but if you maybe indulge me a bit, please, regarding an issue that I raised previously and you addressed, and that is the issue of same-sex couples with foreign partnerships seeking to marry in Scotland. Now, it is accepted that to fully enact the 2014 Act, there's further SSIs will require to come. I wonder if you're able to give an update on that particular matter, given the previous undertaking to do everything possible to facilitate that, please.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, this is something I would like to have been able to do quicker, but actually the law is very, very complicated to get right. Now, I think we've issued the draft discussion document to the committee just a couple of days ago. I don't know if you've had a chance to look at it yet. And obviously, before we actually issue the formal documentation, we'll be very interested in the committee's comments on the draft. But as soon as we get your comments back, we intend very quickly then to formally launch the consultation through that document. And clearly, we need to legislate next year in this matter. Can I say that this is quite complicated, mainly because of the different attitudes of other jurisdictions. The way in which some jurisdictions, I think I'm right in saying Denmark, doesn't regard this as a major big problem, but potentially with a friends in London, they think it might be a problem in relation to the English legislation. I'm going to ask Simon to give you more detail on that. But that's the problem. And we therefore need to end up with legislation and regulations which make sense and at the same time can ensure that people who have had the civil partnership overseas but come to Scotland to get married can do so, because that's obviously the objective.
We've asked some of our EU colleagues what views they would have. And we've also asked our colleagues in England and Wales and Northern Ireland. The Dutch have come in and said, for example, that if Scotland converted a Dutch civil partnership to a marriage, they would, in Holland, regard that as ending the civil partnership in Holland, and they would recognise the marriage. The Germans and Austrians said that they weren't certain, but the chances are they will continue to recognise the civil partnership as a civil union in Germany and Austria. The Poles said that there isn't such a thing as civil union in Poland, so we wouldn't be converting any Polish civil unions because there isn't such a status. The Northern Irish plainly have concerns because they're just against same-sex marriage generally, so they have concerns about the possibility of us changing Northern Irish civil partnerships to a marriage here. And the expectation is they will continue to be recognised as being in a civil partnership in Northern Ireland. Our English colleagues are, as the Cabinet Secretary said, raising a number of issues, and I'm hoping to go down and see them possibly next week to discuss some of them with them. But so far, actually, the most difficult response we've had has actually come from our English opposite numbers rather than from colleagues elsewhere in the EU. And New Zealand, I think, are unlikely to cause a problem because New Zealand already convert overseas civil partnerships to a marriage in certain circumstances.
So fundamentally, the problem is we're dealing with so many jurisdictions who have got so many different approaches that we've got to be able to write legislation in Scotland that is going to be able to accommodate all of that.
I do sense, Cabinet Secretary, there is a strong political will to deliver on that, notwithstanding
Absolutely,
the challenges.
Absolutely, totally. And, you know, had we been able to do so sooner, we would have done it, because I do recognise the importance of it. But I think, hopefully, everybody would agree it's far better to take our time and get it right than to rush into it, and then we find that all sorts of complications. Because, you know, if we get it wrong, it's not us who are going to suffer, it's the couple who are going to suffer. So I think we have a duty to try and get it right.
Thank you very much.
Marco.
Can I just ask, as a parallel, obviously we recognise the divorce and dissolution of these civil partnerships from all of these countries. Was a similar process gone through to set up the legislation for that, and how long did that take ultimately? I know that's possibly going back into the dim and distant past of Scottish governments, but are you able to shed any light on that?
Family Law Act 1986 has got provisions on recognition of overseas divorces. I don't, to be honest, know how long it took for us to reach that decision.
I was referring to the dissolution of foreign civil partnerships, because in 2004 we added to the law. The law yes. contained the dissolution of foreign civil partnerships. This is yes. similar. This is the exchange of foreign civil partnerships. So I take it the process was similar then in checking for consequences in other countries. And how long did that take, if you're aware?
I don't know the answer to that question, to be honest. I mean, when civil partnerships were set up, quite a lot of the provisions in the Civil Partnership Act reflected similar provisions in respect of marriage. So it was the same type of system being established. It was just a parallel system being set up in respect to civil partnerships when compared with marriage. So the position generally is that we recognise overseas dissolutions or overseas divorces of marriages, and similarly we recognise overseas dissolutions of civil partnerships. And the way in which the Civil Partnership Act 2004 works is generally it mirrors the way in which marriage works. It's slightly more complicated here because we have, for example, if you're in a civil partnership, say from the United States, if you change that to a marriage here, the existing civil partnership in the United States might continue. So you might have a civil partnership in the United States, but you might be married in Scotland.
Yes, but I'm specifically referring to what happens if you dissolve here a relationship that was registered abroad. So that in that American example, you could dissolve the civil partnership here under our current law, and then go back to America, and you might not have a guarantee that dissolution of the civil partnership would be recognised there. And it seems to me that throws up the same issues as the exchange of foreign civil partnerships here.
Yes. I mean, it's easier when it's just the one type of relationship, if you follow me. It's easier when it's a divorce of a marriage or a dissolution of a civil partnership. It gets more complicated if... it is the divorce of a relationship which is recognised as something else in the other jurisdiction. For example, in the Section 104 order, which we've laid at the Westminster, there is specific provision in there so that a Scottish same-sex marriage is recognised as a civil partnership in Northern Ireland. And then there's further provision to say if the Northern Irish courts then dissolve that deemed civil partnership in Northern Ireland as a civil partnership, that deemed dissolution of a civil partnership is recognised as ending the marriage in Scotland and in England. So the difference is that the relationships might be treated differently in different jurisdictions.
Can I move on and ask about the civil partnership marriage fee, please? It says there will be a £30 fee payable to change a civil partnership to marriage and a £10 fee for each requested marriage certificate. However, for those civil partnerships that was registered before the 16th of December, when same-sex marriage was not available, there will only be a £10 charge for each extract of the marriage from the marriage register and certificate. I think the Scottish Government says there's around 5,500 civil partnerships registered in Scotland, and if 5,000 were to change to a marriage in the first year, this would cost approximately £150,000. Can I ask what plans the Scottish Government have to sort of reimburse the local authorities for these costs?
Actually, what we're doing is we're doing it in a slightly different way, Convener. We have transferred resources, £100,000, because I think we think that'll be nearer the figure of the £150,000. We have transferred, or transferring £100,000 from the Scottish Government to the National Records of Scotland. And the local authorities will bill the National Records of Scotland. They'll receive the money paid out of that £100,000 that we've given to the National Records of Scotland. So administratively, that's the easiest way to do it. So local authorities won't lose a penny.
Lovely, that's great. Thanks very much. Can I ask if members have any other questions to ask? No? No. Can I? Yeah. Yeah. Moving on to agenda item four now. It calls for the committee to formally consider and recommend approval of motions, namely S4M-11569, that the Equal Opportunities Committee recommends that the Marriage Between Civil Partners, Procedure for Changing Fees, Scotland Regulations 2014 draft be approved, and SM4-11570, that the Equal Opportunities Committee recommends that the Marriage, Same-Sex Couples, Jurisdiction and Recognition of Judgment Scotland Regulations 2014 draft be approved. I would like to invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak and move motion S4M-11569.
Formally move, Convener.
Thank you. I'd now like to invite members to ask any questions. Alex Johnson.
Not a question, Convener, simply a statement. Members will be aware that I was opposed to the primary legislation which makes these instruments necessary, and I remain opposed in principle to what that legislation achieved. However, I am fully aware that these instruments are necessary to give effect to the will of Parliament, and therefore I will not be opposing them.
Thank you very much. Anybody else get any questions? Any comments? No. Are we all agreed? No, sorry. The question is, sorry, that motion S4M-11569 in the name of Alec Neil be approved. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
All agreed. Thank you. I would now like to invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak and move motion S4M-11570.
Formally move, Convener.
Thank you. Do any members have any comments or any questions? No. So the question is that motion S4M-11569 in the name of Alex Neil be approved. Are we all agreed?
So that's 70, that's our mistake.
That should be 70. Sorry, typing error. S4M-11570 in the name of Alex Neil be approved. Agreed, thank you. That concludes consideration of these affirmative instruments, and we will report the outcome of our consideration to the Parliament. And would like to thank the Cabinet Secretary and others for their participation. Thank you very much. Thank you. And we'll now suspend the meeting till 10 o'clock. What was it?
Just
Okay, agenda item 5. Our next item of business today is consideration of a negative instrument, namely the Marriage and Civil Partnership Scotland Act 2014, commencement number 3, saving transitional provision and revocation, order 2014, SSI 2014/287. This instrument brings into force the remaining provision of the 2014 Act, with the exceptions of provisions relating to religious and belief bodies, satisfying qualifying requirements set out in regulations and provisions which increase certain notice periods from 14 to 28 days. This order makes transitional and savings provisions and revokes some regulations which no longer have effect. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee determined that it did not need to draw the instrument to the attention of the Parliament. The committee will now consider any issues that it wishes to raise in reporting to the Parliament on the instrument. Members should note that no motions to annul have been received in relation to this instrument. Do any members have any comments or questions to ask? So, has the committee agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendations in relation to the instrument?
Agreed.
And will now suspendly brief the meeting to allow the next set of Cabinet Secretaries to take their seats. Thank you. Yeah. Good morning. Agenda item 6 is an evidence session to support our scrutiny of the Scottish Government's draft budget for 2015-16. I'd like to welcome John Swinney, Cabinet Secretary for Finance, Employment and Sustainable Growth, and Shona Robinson, Cabinet Secretary for Commonwealth Games, Sports, Equalities and Pensioners' Rights, and their accompanying officials. Can I start by asking you and the officials to introduce yourselves and invite the Cabinet Secretaries to make any opening remarks?
Good morning, Convener. John Swinney, Cabinet Secretary for Finance, Employment and Sustainable Growth.
Morning. Shona Robinson, Cabinet Secretary for Commonwealth Games, Sport, Equalities and Pensioners' Rights.
Yvonne Strachan, Head of Equality, Human Rights and Third Sector for the Scottish Government.
Alison Taylor, Head of Integration of Health and Social Care in the Scottish Government.
Okay. Can I just check that Cabinet Secretaries don't have any opening remarks you would like to make?
We can make some brief opening remarks, Convener, if that would help, or very happy to go into questions if the committee would prefer that.
If you would like to make opening remarks, okay. That would be fine.
Thank you, Convener. I think this is a welcome opportunity for us to discuss the draft budget with the committee, and I think it's also welcome that the Cabinet Secretary for Commonwealth Games, Equalities, Pensions, Rights and Sport is with me today, given that we changed our approach to the handling of the equalities issues and the equalities assessment over the budget process to be a process over which both of us preside as part of the scrutiny of the wider issues of government. The draft budget is set, as members will be aware, against a contrasting time of economic performance within Scotland. We are without doubt moving from recession into recovery, and one of the challenges of that period is to ensure that as new economic opportunities emerge, we are able to support individuals in sharing in that opportunity. The challenges inherent in the budget focus very much on addressing some of the issues of economic recovery, but also about tackling the consequences of welfare reform, and the government has set out a range of different measures to ensure that these points are adequately and fully taken into account. The government also learns strong lessons from the referendum process, which demonstrated the level of public engagement there is in the political process. So therefore, the steps that we've taken through the establishment of the equality statement and the wider dialogue we have with stakeholders around issues in connection with the formulation of the budget is ever more significant, given the fact that we have a very active political debate and climate at the present moment. Very different features of the budget this year is the ability to set tax rates, and as the government has considered the issues in connection with the setting of land and buildings transaction tax and the Scottish landfill tax, we have taken into account a number of principles of taxation which have been designed to address issues which we consider appropriately and adequately address the equalities questions. Finally, Convener, and before my colleague Shona Robinson makes some remarks, I would want to place on record my grateful thanks to the Equality Budget Advisory Group, who continue to advise the government on these questions. They have undertaken their role this year without the assistance and contribution of Professor Ailsa Mackay, who sadly died this year, and Professor Mackay had made a very significant contribution to the formulation of our approach to equalities budget issues, and I'm grateful to the members of EBAG for continuing that input in the course of this budget process.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Just very briefly, just to also, as John Swinney has, pay tribute to the work of the Equality Budget Advisory Group. It's been very helpful indeed. We're giving particular emphasis in our spending decisions to those measures that will drive growth and will help families and households. I know the committee has a particular focus on age in its scrutiny this year, and you'll see that there are a range of spending priorities that will benefit both younger and older people. One of the key focuses for older people is, of course, the £173.5 million that we're investing on the integration of health and social care, which aims, of course, to improve the delivery of services to, and most importantly, the outcomes for older people in our country. Finally, we've been able to maintain our funding support for the third sector and for equality activities. Without a doubt, the work of the third sector is absolutely crucial to supporting older people in particular and providing services in the health and care sector. Our equality budget enables us to support activities such as the Age Scotland Helpline, which is very well utilised, and the engagement of older people in debate and dialogue about public policy and issues of concern to them. I've been very pleased to have had the responsibility for equality and to have seen the strong commitment and new processes of making equality a key part of the budget process. Very happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I'll ask the first question, and it's actually to do with the reduction in Skills Development Scotland's budget. Coming from previously a training background and having worked with Skills Development Scotland, I'm quite familiar with the sort of the costs and the delivery of training. You're reducing the budget by 1.8%, which is equivalent to like £4 million. And there's a 1.5% reduction, which is £15.8 million, to the budget for education and lifelong learning and meeting the national outcomes. Would you like to sort of comment on that and what impact that would actually have on Skills Development Scotland?
The numbers I have in front of me, Convener, are that on Skills Development Scotland, the budget line was 184 million in 14-15, and it's going to 183.5 million in 15-16, which is a reduction of 0.3%. Given the challenges that we face in relation to the wider budget issues, Convener, and the fact that we're facing a real terms reduction in our budget this year, what I've tried to do is to maintain a range of interventions that support the journey of people into employment. Skills Development Scotland is just one aspect of this. We also have £12.7 million for Youth Employment Scotland in the budget, which goes with a variety of other measures. You know, Community Jobs Scotland, for example, is another area where we've sustained the funding between 14-15 and 15-16. So I think what I would say, Convener, is that we are we obviously face a strategic budget challenge, but what we're trying to do is to protect the resources that are available to support people to make that journey back into employment, because we believe that journey into employment is the best route for all individuals. And I think the combination of the different measures that we take, I should also make the point, Convener, that in those sums that I've talked about already, we have the additional investment to support the implementation of Sir Ian Wood's report on developing Scotland's young workforce. So I think when you look at it in the round of Skills Development Scotland, developing young people's workforce, and also the Youth Employment Scotland budget, I think there's a strong level of support that's available. And of course, in the college sector, into the bargain, the budget is going from £522 million to £526 million in 15-16. So I think these are areas that are well supported by public expenditure.
Yeah, I think my concern is that after hearing the evidence from young people and the various organisations, is that it is really, really important that there is the support and the financial support there to make sure those young people actually transition from school into employment or training if they're not ready yet to go straight into employment in college. And I'm concerned that you've said by 2020 we'll have 30,000 modern apprentices. One, I'm concerned after hearing also from training providers that the funding is staying the same, or in some cases it's been reduced to deliver the same qualifications, that it's going to make it all the more difficult for the harder to reach young people actually also get jobs as well through the modern apprenticeship programme.
The first thing I'd say, Convener, is I agree wholeheartedly with your remarks about the importance of supporting young people through that journey. I think for every young person that we are unable to properly support or engage with, and of course, as we all know, school doesn't suit every young person, so therefore there will be other interventions that are made available which are designed to be appropriate to the needs of young people. For every young person that we are unable to support properly,
My view is the longer term costs mm-hmm. of that failure to support on the public purse will be even greater, because mm-hmm. I think, without wishing to be depressing about it, I think we can probably imagine there'll be poorer outcomes yeah. further down the track, and therefore greater demands on public services and public expenditure. So getting that support correct for young people is very important. And I think that the various measures that we have in place are designed to do exactly that. And of course, there will be young people who will face some other challenges that will be supported by other areas of public expenditure, whether it's around the assistance that we might put in place to support more vulnerable young people through the expansion of the Getting It Right for Every Child programme and the Opportunities for All initiatives that relate to older young people. Second point is on modern apprenticeships, where there is clearly we will go on a pattern of expansion of modern apprenticeship capability to reach the 30,000 target by 2020. That will have to be done incrementally over the course of the next spending review and the next parliamentary term. But I think what we've demonstrated is that over the course of the last few years, we've managed to sustain very significant expansion in modern apprenticeships, going from about 15,000 to 25,000 over the lifetime of this government. That is, of course, crucially dependent on the participation of employers, because employers are key to the modern apprenticeship programme in Scotland. And I'm optimistic as we move into stronger periods of employment growth within Scotland that employers will be able to partner with us in that journey. The final observation, Convener, is about cost of programmes and value. I have to say to the committee, one of the constant themes that I have been pressing public services on and public authorities from throughout my term in office has been to maximise value for the public purse. And sometimes that involves some pretty challenging conversations and challenging relationships about how we get value for money out of some of these contractual arrangements. I'm satisfied that those discussions, whilst they might not suit everybody, I think are justified in ensuring that we get value for money and that we can ensure that the resources we have available to us are able to have as wide an impact as they possibly can do.
Okay. I think Siobhan wants to come in on that, and then I'll get another question.
It was simply on the Modern Apprenticeship Programme, Cabinet Secretary, and this is something that I've asked in a number of budget sessions now, so I don't wish to disappoint you and ask again. Obviously, we've seen with the Modern Apprenticeship Scheme the increasing numbers, but we've also seen a pattern of females not getting through to the higher levels of the scheme, and we also have 0.5% of disabled people in the scheme. We also don't have information on some protected characteristics at present. In previous sessions, you have said that you're working towards getting more information. We understand that there's problems with getting that information at the minute, but Skills Development Scotland are working towards a new programme of trying to get that information to us and recruiting from certain sectors. So I'm just wondering what progress has been made and what allocation of the budget has gone into this, given that we're seeing, although we dispute the figures, a reduction in the funding to Skills Development Scotland.
I think the on the question of sourcing data, then, you know, I think I'm very happy to ensure that the government acts as far as we possibly can do to address the aspirations of the committee for more detailed statistics on this area of activity. So it may actually be one of the things the committee might wish to consider is to make a very specific proposition about what information would be helpful to collect and to gather, so the government can respond to that very specifically on the points that the committee would be most interested on. Because, as I think I've perhaps rehearsed in my answers in previous years to Siobhan McMahon, there's no shortage of statistics collected in government, believe you me. Whether they're all useful and current for our needs at the present time is a completely different question. So if the committee wished to set out a framework of statistical information that it would consider to be helpful, then I would be very happy to look at that and to establish what was required. On the question of funding, I really don't see this as being a particular problem in the collection of statistical data on a cohort of the size of the modern apprenticeship grouping, given the fact that we already are collecting statistics on that cohort already. It doesn't strike me as being something that would be of particularly significant cost. But if the committee wished to be specific to the government, we'd certainly happily consider those proposals.
Secretary, last time, last year when you were here giving evidence, we were talking about the problems with the third sector and also other organisations that deliver the training programmes. They were saying that there was issues with only having yearly contracts, and I asked you about that and you said you would look at that and bring it back to the committee. Can you tell me any further forward in actually considering a three-year contract or longer for these organisations?
We have made quite a bit of progress in that question. As members will recall, the Conservative Party brought forward a debate on essentially the question of three-year funding for third sector organisations, which took place in Parliament some time ago. And as a consequence of that, I agreed in the debate that we would lead a process of discussion with the third sector and with local government, as between the Scottish Government, local government, we represented such a comprehensive part of the contracting approach to these areas within Scotland. We've had a number of discussions with local government, and the third sector has been actively involved in all of those processes to essentially move towards a situation where we have a greater presumption in favour of longer-term funding. And that can only be deployed, as you will appreciate, convener, on a case-by-case basis. But it certainly is our objective to try to move more and more of our contracting basis to that longer-term period. It does also involve us with that crucial challenge that I responded to a moment ago to you, convener, that we have to also maintain very strong scrutiny of value questions over the length of these contracts. And these considerations are now being actively taken forward in the contracting structures that we take forward as a government.
Thank you very much for that. And can I pass you over to Marco now?
Thank you, Convener. The third sector and opportunities for all are two areas that are very important, in particular for young people with additional support needs. Can we be sure that there's adequate funding by looking at the budget, or is this something where the great majority of the spending is going to come through the local government settlement?
I think there's a in both the areas of the third sector and the Opportunities for All programme, there will be elements that come out of some of the programmes that over which the government presides, and some will come out of the wider local government settlement. For the government's part, we have maintained our funding to the third sector. It's been part of the long-term commitment the Cabinet has wanted to make to ensure that the third sector organisations are properly and fully supported, recognising the strategic role we expect the third sector, well, we require the third sector to perform in the delivery of public services, in articulating on behalf of groups with particular needs and requirements, but then also in finding new ways of working to improve outcomes for citizens within Scotland. So our support has been very strong there. Obviously, local government has to make its own decisions, and I have strenuously worked to ensure that local government gives adequate and due priority to the needs of the third sector. I think one of the areas where I sympathise with committees such as the Equal Opportunities Committee is that the format of the budget document doesn't lend itself to addressing directly the question that Mr. Biaggi raises, because we set out information in a whole variety of different ways to be consistent with our agreements with the Finance Committee, but perhaps a configuration of the budget in a different fashion would make it slightly more obvious to the committees such as the Equal Opportunities Committee, and other committees make the same point to me as I discuss budget issues with them. What helps us in this process is the alignment of our policy frameworks, which are designed to, where both the Scottish Government and local government agree on some strategic priorities. You know, we work to the same national outcomes, we work to the same indicative targets of performance, and that is designed to give a cohesion and a focus to the way in which we deliver the... We take the decisions that we take on spending decisions in order that they can most effectively reflect the needs and the aspirations of people at local level.
And finally from me, the cost of delivering support through either the third sector or opportunities for all for young people with additional support needs is greater than the average for a young person. Can we be sure that that is coming through, that priority is being afforded, and that the results are there for young people with additional support needs based on the budget?
I would certainly believe that to be the case. I acknowledge that the fundamental point that Mr. Biaggi makes, which is that there will be a higher cost to support young people with additional support needs. That has to be reflected both in and is reflected in local authority decisions. Clearly, for young people with additional support needs, local authorities will be putting in place support packages which will be significantly greater cost than would be the case for young people without additional support needs. And the same maxim applies in relation to opportunities for all and also in relation to the support which is delivered through budgets through the college sector into the bargain.
Thank you, Marco. Fine. Christian, do you want to come in a supplementary?
Yeah, I will keep on with my question on verbatim subject, because we heard a lot from the evidence we took that not only about young people with additional support needs, but over a transition period, a lot of the third sector providers in rural and island areas will have extra cost, of course. And just to know if you have factored for this in your draft budget for this extra cost for local providers in rural and island areas.
Some of these judgments will be will be reflected in the decisions made by Skills Development Scotland, for example, in the delivery of contractual arrangements in remoter areas. And of course, in the local authority settlement, there is specific provision made for to take due account of rurality and remoteness, and in the case of the islands of Scotland, to take into account the particular additional costs that are incurred in delivering services to our island communities, which is reflected in the element of the local government settlement that's influenced by the special islands supplement. There is a wider reassurance I would give to the committee, which is that we have a commitment across the board to ensure, the government's purpose is to ensure that there are opportunities for all of Scotland to flourish. I stress all of Scotland to flourish through increasing sustainable economic growth. What that means is that whether one lives in central Edinburgh or in the Western Isles, each individual is entitled to be able to have access to opportunities. So therefore, the funding support and the way in which we deliver services is designed to address that particular requirement.
One theme always came back was particularly the cost of transport.
Yes.
And is there anything in the draft budget which is targeted particularly the cost of transport in rural areas?
Well, these factors will be reflected in the judgments made about the cost of delivery of services in particular localities. It would be incumbent on the contracting organisations to take that point into account.
Thank you. And another question regarding, you talked about the Get It Right for Every Child policy. Because we scrutinise the draft budget on the transition period for young people, especially young people with additional support needs, is there a possibility maybe that the government will think of extending that policy to older young people, maybe to take it post school to make sure that we've got that transition period?
The Opportunities for All commitment extends to... I'm just having a... 16 to 19. Yes, 16 to 19, I'm now doubting myself about that, but so we have a commitment to make sure that every young person is given a proper assured guarantee of support to assist them to make their journey into the labour market. Some of that will be done through the school and college environment, some will be done through other programmes that the government deploys. But I think that's an indication of the type of practical support we can make available to young people in that context.
Is there some evidence we took found that a lot of these young people, especially the one with additional support needs, found it very difficult to have the cliff that, you know, when the gear effect stops, yeah, and there is no more support afterwards. So if there were a possibility, the Scottish Government could see how we could extend it and maybe fund it a period, a bigger period after after school would be held.
I think that's a very fair point. But of course, you know, in circumstances where I hadn't quite focused on the point about additional of young people with additional support needs, there is likely to be an ongoing requirement for public authorities, principally local authorities, to put in place support mechanisms for young people as they become older, which will be tailored to their requirements. And the obligation in the government's care approach, the obligations that are taken in that are taken forward in relation to the pursuit of better outcomes for all citizens, will place an obligation on public authorities to make sure that the individual needs of people are properly and fully reflected in the choices that we make over spending decisions.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And can I ask Alec Johnson now to move on?
Yes, thank you, Convener. I note that there's £16.6 million additional has been allocated to training youth and women's employment. Is it possible to give us some detail on how that will be allocated or how it will be broken down?
It's the main areas where that is happening will be across the uplift that's been put in place to the work to implement Serene Wood's recommendations on developing Scotland's young workforce. So in the budget in 14-15 we allocated £12 million, and we've now increased that by 38% to £16.6 million, and that will be focused on expanding the apprenticeship programme, on encouraging more vocational learning opportunities for young people while in school, and the establishment, and this relates in a sense to some of the points that Mr. Allard was raising with me, the establishment of better integration between schools and colleges and preparing young people for work. So that's one area where there is an expansion. The other area is in relation to the expansion of Youth Employment Scotland, I should say the continuation of Youth Employment Scotland, which will be a mechanism designed to ensure that we meet the needs of young people in accessing the labour market, and that we leverage in other private, public and European funding to support that process into the bargain. So those would be the areas where there is the most significant difference in the work that is taken forward.
Yep. Just briefly, was there any impact assessment on how that money might help those people with disabilities and additional support needs to access the workplace?
As part of the equalities assessment, we are testing portfolios and the budget propositions that they bring forward, that they support the process of improving outcomes for all individuals. So for young people with disabilities, that will have been one of the factors that will have been considered as part of this process. Again, I come back to the obligations that we have to improve outcomes for individuals, which are reflected in the budget choices that we make. So these are issues which are essentially tested in the equalities budget statement and the budget process, which the mm-hmm. Cabinet Secretary and I preside over, to ensure that the wider expectations that individuals could have of the effect of the government's programme are actually fulfilled by the spending choices we make.
Of that money, £12.7 million appears to be allocated to a new budget line of youth employment. Is that the same as the budget you were describing for Youth Employment Scotland?
Yeah.
Is there any other information you can give as to the breakdown of how that 12 £1.7 million will be spent?
The themes that it will cover will be to support the principle of early intervention, to support young people in securing worthwhile employment. Mm. It's, in a sense, my point in response to the convener a moment ago, that for every moment a young person is not being supported and encouraged and nurtured to enter the labour market or to be involved in a good destination through education, we are in danger of walking into having a worse outcome and a further demand on public services. So Youth Employment Scotland is designed to try to ensure that that journey is made as smooth and as is possible and is as well supported as is possible to ensure that the needs of individuals are met as a consequence. And the early intervention point is designed to make a judgment as to whether or not, you know, for some young people, staying around in school can actually be a negative outcome for them. And making that judgment as early as possible that a different approach or a different setting might benefit that young person is a crucial judgment which will ultimately in the long term deliver better outcomes for us, for those individuals, and better outcomes for society.
Is there any extent to which the method of getting the means to the people who need it is something that will have to be developed over time, or is there a plan in place to achieve that on day one?
Well, I think that we've got a lot of very good channels of work that are taken forward that are very effective. Increasingly, our public service reform agenda is concentrating on a person-centred approach, so that we actually tailor the way in which public services are delivered to meet the needs of an individual, as opposed to having a happy coincidence if public services happen to support an individual very directly. We're trying to meet the needs of individuals increasingly. So these the sums of money that we've talked about this morning are designed to support individuals in that journey. And you know, just yesterday morning I had a conversation with the Chair of Skills Development in Scotland, John McClelland, about the extent to which individual person-centred packages are being put together which are better meeting the needs of these individuals. And as a consequence, we're having lower dropout rates, we are having more sustained participation, and we're getting better outcomes as a consequence.
Thank you.
Thank you. Before I move on, I'd maybe like to ask the other Cabinet Secretary if she's got any comments she'd like to make. Or has everything been covered?
I think Mr. Swinney's dealt with it very comprehensively. I suppose, you know, there are other budgets that will impact and some of the areas that have been touched on in terms of, if you take the broadest definition of children with additional needs or vulnerable children, you know, I was thinking specifically about the Children's Services Fund of over £3 million, which is going to support the network of workers for children and young people affected by domestic abuse. So that won't sit within the budgets that Sir Swinney was talking about, but nevertheless, in terms of a vulnerable group of children and young people, that support is very, very important. So maybe just to put that on the record.
That's lovely. Thank you very much. And I'll move on now to John Mason.
Thanks, Convener. Yes, I mean, I would like to kind of direct this at Shona Robinson, if I may, because John Swinney's already kind of referred in his answer to Christian Allard about transition and this whole thing about moving from... And I've seen one or two constituents myself where up to 16 or even 18, they're at school and they get quite a lot of support, and then they kind of, there does seem to be quite a kind of drop-off, and this transition doesn't always seem to work. So from your angle, you know, is it working on the whole, this move from kind of pre-16 through to post-16?
I think it depends on which group of young people you're talking about.
Well,
if you look, for example, of young people who are using health services and care services, so young people with a disability, there are challenges, I think, when they move out of the support that they may have attended either mainstream school or a special school, and they then move into adult services. I think a lot of work has been done around that, but it's still challenging and can be particularly quite scary for parents, I think, when they feel that there's a danger of them losing the support package that they've had, which is a very clear routine for the day, and then they're moving into an assessment for adult services. So a lot of work has been carried out on transition there. Have we got it perfectly right? Probably still some work to be done in making sure every local authority and every health board works very closely together in making that happen. A lot of the focus around the integration has been particularly on older adults, but without a doubt, I think there's opportunities there to get it right for younger adults who are moving in to that system, and by making sure that there's far better communication and earlier communication around not just the budgets, but around the support mechanism, even the people who may change in terms of supporting that family. But the budget is an important element of that, without a doubt.
Yeah, I mean, John Swain's already made the point that, you know, in one sense we look at the budget and we don't see third sector, or we don't see a particular area because it's not done that way.
Yeah.
So, I mean, do we just have to accept that we can't really influence that? Because we're giving money to the local authorities, they look after the schools and the social work, then we give money to the health board and they look after other things. Now, I know there's meant to be more joint working going on, but is it just too far away from us for us to really have a big influence on that?
Maybe more work could be done. We could certainly look at this about how we pull some of that out, perhaps use case studies as a bit more of an example to focus on best practice and which budgets are supporting that young person moving in a transition from one service to another. But I think, as John Swinney said earlier, I can understand that it doesn't make the life of this committee easy to be able to see that and to see all the different budgets that impact on that person's life. There's maybe some work that we could do to maybe make that more transparent, but it's quite challenging because, as you've identified yourself, that support sits within various budgets. Some are local authorities, some are health boards, some are budgets that we hold directly, and it's how all of that sits around that individual person. Maybe a case study model might be a good way of doing that.
I mean, just to kind of follow on. Sorry, yes, Mr. Swain. Sorry.
To what Cabinet Secretary has said, and that is that there is a much greater degree of alignment of public expenditure to support the priorities and the objectives of government. And it's not, I wouldn't for a moment say it's perfect, it'll never be perfect, but it's a great deal more aligned than it's ever been in the past. And what's enabled us to do that has been our strategic agreement with local government to work on shared priorities. As a consequence of that, the ability of ministers to direct, for example, the health service, the ministers to direct public bodies, and the agreement of local government to work on broadly a shared agenda of what we are trying to achieve collectively with the public expenditure at our disposal. A lot of this is assessed and considered within the National Performance Framework, but we now have a much more integrated policy framework which enables us to essentially be working in broadly the same direction. And I would be confident that if you had, for example, the leaders of local authorities here, they would be explaining very similar policy priorities that they were working to, as would be taken forward by Scottish ministers.
I would just add as well that the new integration authorities themselves will be gathering a lot of data which should be able to identify more clearly where the spend is and how, in more detail, how that resource is being spent across those two large spending organisations, which might help to answer some of the detail, particularly at a more local level.
Will you as government be assessing how well these partnerships are working?
Absolutely.
Because, I mean, from a non-budget point of view, it's been raised a few times that data sharing is not very good, except that's not particularly a budget issue, but schools are reluctant to either pass on to colleges or the third sector particular data. And, I mean, just my general feeling, both on this committee and I'm also in the Finance Committee, is that it is a little bit patchy around the country. And I mean, Highland tends to be given as the good example of the health service and the local worker working together. I think there's other good examples. I get other we've had other people from other councils at both committees where I just, my gut feeling is it's not moving forward as fast as it might be.
I mean, the integrated integration authorities have to move forward because obviously the legislation is in place. They've been given two possible models to follow. It's fair to say the pace has been quicker in some areas than in others, but they are now all getting there. They've all chosen the model that they're going to follow. So without a doubt, that's going to force a lot of change and the bringing together of the budgets are going to focus minds. They're working very hard on the strategic plans. We will absolutely have oversight of that and a great deal of discussion from officials. Alison Taylor is very, very close to this, so she might want to add a little in addition to what I've said. But without a doubt, this is a big, big opportunity, but we need to make sure that it delivers some of the change that we all know needs to happen. And getting this right at a local level is a huge opportunity for service users who rely on both services. Alison, do you want to?
Thank you. Yes, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I would just add, completely recognise the concerns about the availability and the sharing of data. If data isn't joined up and shared effectively, it undermines the capacity of the whole system to plan, particularly for people who have multiple conditions, which is the real focus of integration, which is why so many people who are involved are older people. So we have a lot of work underway nationally to support local linking of data, as Ms. Robison has described. And I think that from that, and from the annual performance reports that the new partnerships will produce, we will begin to get a much richer seam of evidence about what's happening and for whose benefit. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Moving on now to the subject of older people in health and wellbeing. Siobhan would like to start the questions.
Thank you. The first question is about the change fund. We heard an evidence that the funding or the resourcing has now ceased and that the continuation of developed initiatives is now assumed to be included within the baseline funding allocated to partnership boards. So it was just a question on why there has been a reduction in the change fund resources. And what has been done to sustain the improvements and outcomes in the absence of that?
Well, there's the new integrated care fund is really building upon the change fund that preceded it, and that's going to be £173.5 million for 15-16. The important thing to say about that, though, is that the integrated partnerships will have a scope to look at joint budgets of around £7.6 billion. So the use of the £173.5 million is to really continue some of the groundbreaking work of redesigning services, showcasing what can work, and then with the expectation that that will be a good model for practice for all of those integrated authorities going forward. So it's a catalyst, that budget is a catalyst for change, but the big resource sits within both health and social care, which is why it's being brought together. So that £7.6 billion is really the resource that the integrated partnerships need to focus on, but using the £173.5 million to test some of the changes that need to unlock some of the resources tied up in doing things that we know are not the most effective. How do we keep people at home for longer? How do we shift that resource? Some of that resource, that £173.5 million, will build on the how to do that, that the change fund has been very useful at doing before that. But really, we need to keep our eye on the £7.6 billion because that's the, if we can unlock that resource, that's where the real change will happen and the way people receive services at a local level.
I appreciate that answer, Cabinet Secretary, and I appreciated in your opening statement that you said so the Integration Fund is about improving services and outcomes for older people. However, in evidence we heard that the culture is still, as much as government policy has been to try and shape the reshaping care initiative and getting people to stay at home longer, as you said yourself, that actually the spending that has been put there, as one witness said, 1% sort of goes into that and the rest is in acute services still. So I'm just wondering what specifically in the integration fund now will change that, because our witnesses, and I asked them, I said, you know, we would all like more money. It's not simply about money. But can they shift this balance with the resources that they've been given? And the answer was no.
Well, the whole reason that the legislation has been put in place, bringing those two big spending organisations together, is to do just that. Because, you know, well, I go back to my days as a home care organiser in the early 1990s, we were talking about this agenda then, which is why we've reached the point of putting in place legislation to require both those organisations, not just to come together, but to essentially pool their budgets. And it was always, that was the missing bit, was the pooling of budgets. Because at the end of the day, whether it's human nature or system nature, when there were two separate budgets with two separate responsibilities, there was always going to be barriers to real change. So the legislation bringing those bodies together, bringing those budgets together, is the difference, in my view, that will make the difference, importantly, for service users. The unlocking of that $7.6 billion, is that going to happen overnight and a sweeping change overnight? No, but the gradual change and shift of that resource, I believe, has a very, very strong chance of now happening because of that accountability for that joint budget. And the catalyst for change will certainly be pushing from the centre and making sure the momentum is there locally. There's a lot of good work going on in many areas of the country that recognises that this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for substantial change. All areas will make those changes. Fair to say some are getting on and doing it quicker than others, but they will all do it. Absolutely.
I think if I could, I think this is an absolutely fundamental question that's been raised, and it's at the heart of the government's agenda and what needs to be addressed. There are three other areas that I would add to what the Cabinet Secretary said. First is to give one example, a practical example. I recently visited the integrated services in Highland. And I spoke to members of staff who previously were health board staff and previously were local authority staff, and they're now working together. And they've got the one employer in an integrated service. And what struck me about that discussion was that these individuals, because they had been sort of liberated from the organisational culture of their two organisations and were now focused on the people they were serving as opposed to the organisations they had to act on behalf of, they were able to operate in a much more cohesive fashion than they'd ever been able to manage to work in the past. Second thing is about the third sector. Crucial to this journey of shifting the balance from dependence on acute care, for example, to supporting people more effectively in their homes, is the performance and the contribution of the third sector and their ability to be big players in that journey. And that's a major theme of what the government is trying to advance. And then finally, in the budget, as a consequence of the budget decisions that we have made on the health budget, the health secretary has been able to allocate more resources to primary care, which he announced just last week to the tune of £40 million. And what that will help to do is to give some, I think, important additional resource to strengthening primary care to try to assist more of that shift of resources to take place. But what I would accept wholeheartedly is the fact that, and I've heard the Health Secretary make this point in the Chamber on numerous occasions, it costs £4,000 a week to support and care for an individual in an acute hospital. It costs £400 a week if they're in their own home. Now, it doesn't take an awful lot to work out what's the preferable, you know, from the perspective of the Finance Secretary, what is the more preferable approach to be taking. So the more we can drive this shift, but what I would accept is that this is a process that has to be relentlessly driven by government in association with our local authority partners, and that is exactly what ministers are focused on doing.
I welcome both the Cabinet Secretary's answers, and I do support what you're trying to do. So I'm just wondering then, given that the Cabinet Secretary for Equalities said that this won't happen overnight, and I fully appreciate that it won't happen overnight, Will the funding streams then continue, because they're obviously not identified at the present moment, so will there be more funding streams coming down the line? You anticipate, I understand that we're talking about one budget at the minute, but you know, I'm not suggesting a figure or anything else at the minute, but you anticipate that.
Obviously, we only have financial information up to the financial year 2015-16. We haven't been provided with any longer-term information. What I can say is that this is an absolutely strategic priority of the Scottish Government. This is the route to enabling us to create sustainable health and social care services, and it has to work, and it has to be supported to with sufficient political and organisational leadership, but also with resources to make sure that it can happen.
I think during 15-16 we'll get a far sharper focus on what's working, and it's then about driving what works to make sure that's what happens to deliver that change, and that will inevitably influence any future spending decisions.
And finally on that then, Cabinet Secretary, will you be evaluating the process, given that it should achieve the 9 national outcomes for the health and social care partnerships?
Absolutely. I mean, there will be a sharp, sharp focus on delivery here and making sure that we are evaluating and making sure that at a local level the aspirations that John Swinney was talking about in terms of making sure this delivers, not just in terms of the budget delivering, but we know it works better for people, particularly older people. An acute hospital bed is the last place someone who doesn't need to be there. Obviously, if they need to be there, then they need to be there. But for too many older people, they don't, and we know it's not good for them either. So from a budgetary and a care perspective, we have to and will make this work, absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you. John Mason, do you have any questions you'd like to ask?
Just follow on from where we've been, because Siobhan Mann's kind of moved into the area, although it's specifically the change funds and the integration funds, the whole point about keeping people at home and how that moves resources. And that was the area I was kind of going to come in on here as well. I mean, so clearly there is the change fund, the integration fund, and that money is to kind of change things over. And I mean, Mr. Swinney, you've made the point that, you know, it's so much more expensive having somebody in hospital than somebody at home. I mean, is there anything in the budget that is moving that along, that process, or are we just giving the money to the NHS and the local authorities and it's up to them to pull it and start moving the resources within that, or can we do anything at the from the top-down level?
Well, the £173.5 million for next year is the budget that just to help oil the wheels of change, if you like. We expect change to happen and we expect them to look at that £7.6 billion and shifting that resource. But the £173.5 million is to help bits of the system change.
So, I mean, sorry, that's kind of extra bit, isn't it,
yeah.
On top of what the underlying bit. So at the end of a year, you would expect the underlying bit to have changed?
Well, we expect the strategic plans to lay out how that's going to happen. Now, that's not all going to shift in the space of one financial year. But what we would expect to see is evidence of change. And they'll set out in their strategic plans how they're going to do it, by what stage they would expect to do what. And that, you know, we will be putting a lot of attention on the robustness of those plans and making sure that they are workable, that they cut the mustard, quite frankly, and that we begin to see over a period of time the shift in the balance of care that we absolutely need to see happen. So those plans will be subjected to a great deal of scrutiny, not just by the government, but locally as well.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Moving on now to John Finney.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, some of the points I was going to cover have been picked up. If I can maybe go back to the sum of £43 million that was issued, the announcement recently there of the additional monies. Is that part of the 173?
Yeah, the £40 million is part of the £173.5 million.
And it was, if I noted the Cabinet Secretary, Mr. Swinney, correctly, said it was for strengthening primary care. Is it targeted both geographically and to deprived areas?
Well, I think when the Cabinet Secretary for Health, Alec Neil, announced it, from recollection, Alison can fill in some of the detail here, it was focused particularly on tackling inequality. So to strengthen those primary care services in both urban areas of deprivation, but also rural areas where rurality was a significant factor. Alison, do you want to fill in?
Just to add, there are discussions ongoing about exactly how to fulfil that aim, how to spend what parts of the money in what way, which involve the professional organisations as well as officials and, of course, ministers in due course. But that's absolutely correct. Its emphasis is on equalities and as they manifest themselves differently in rural and urban areas.
Yeah, I was very pleased to see the announcement, particularly the reference to rural, and I've been seeking to try and establish when decisions will be made. Indeed, I recently asked the chair of NHS Highland, well, when are we likely to know when that money is going to be, where and when?
Well, those discussions are ongoing at the moment, and I'm sure what we'll make sure is that as those discussions progress, that information is obviously shared with local members. But we want to test the proposals to make sure that they absolutely deliver the shifting balance of care. So they're strengthening primary care to be able to make that happen, and that they deliver on some of the key issues that have been raised around whether it's the demands on primary care services within deprived communities or whether it's some of the rurality issues. But we'll make sure that we can share that information with you as those decisions are taken forward.
Thank you. Are you able to see if that's a one-off or will that be a recurring payment or is it just...
Well, the 173.5 million, of which the 40 is part, is allocated for 15-16. I think as we touched on earlier on, as we see what works over the 15-16, that will influence any further budgetary decisions that we would make around driving forward some of those changes. But we need to monitor very closely what works, and we'll do that over 15-16.
Thank you. There's some lovely phrases in all these papers. Primary medical services quality and outcomes framework. Being one of them. Will that increase incentives from general practitioners to involve the third sector?
Well, the QOF is a very interesting process, which essentially is a discussion and agreement with primary care around what they will focus on and what they will be paid for in terms of the QOF. And that has changed over years to reflect some of the kind of joint priorities, and Alison can probably give you a bit more of the detail around that, but it is a very significant lever, because if we get an agreement around a particular objective being part of the QOF, then you're more guaranteed for that to be delivered because it's linked very clearly to payment for that service.
Absolutely. One aspect of the GMS, the General Medical Services contract, that we've adjusted recently is that we've included within it provision to enable every practice to have a link with the integrated partnerships. That's a very first step. It doesn't guarantee that a GP is directly involved in any given discussion, but it does create a liaison, which is very important. In terms of building in the third sector, we have within the integrated arrangements requirements for partnerships to establish localities, which are smaller areas in the whole local authority area, if you like. And our emphasis for these localities is that GPs and other local professionals must have a leading role in helping to develop what services are appropriate to the population. There is also a guaranteed role for third sector representatives in that arrangement. There's also a guaranteed role for third sector representatives and indeed for primary care on strategic planning, around strategic planning tables, if you like. So we've sort of knitted it in at various points of the system. Try to get this collective effort behind shifting the balance.
And could I just add on to this? I think that part of the ground that Mr. Finney is considering is also some of the points that John Mason was raising. And it gets to the heart of some of the dilemmas that government has to address about how we control and distribute public funds. On the one hand, we get pressed to direct the money to this particular cause, requirement, service in this specification, in this locality. And on the other hand, we get encouraged to, well,
local solutions flourish for local needs. It's different in Inverness to what it's like in Dundee or whatever it happens to be. So we have these are essentially, that sums up the dilemmas that we are faced with and we're pressed on. And what the way the government has tried to go through that has been to essentially create the integrated and aligned framework for policy making that we've got between the areas that we directly control, so that health ministers today can direct health boards to do, well, it's got a certain ability to direct health boards to do certain things. I have no ability to direct a local authority to do anything. They're democratically elected organisations, they're free to do well. So what we've tried to create is an integrated policy framework that everyone submits to, and that we leave sufficient room for local discretion to enable the design of a system in Caerleon-Lochalsh to be appropriate for Caerleon-Lochalsh, and the design of a system for Central Dundee to be appropriate for Central Dundee. But what we're trying to do is to create alignment between public bodies and focusing on the needs of individuals in these localities.
Can I pick up on something you said earlier, Cabinet Secretary, about and indeed it was the Special Island Supplement, and the issue of whether agencies delivering work on behalf of the government follow a similar approach? Because we heard last week about training provision and the fact that if it's X for fulfilling a task, regardless of whether it's the centre of a city in the central belt or on the island of Islay, then that's not going to tally up and it reduces incentives for engagement.
I'd have to check on particular contractual arrangements as to whether there is any specific cash factors that take into account in those respects. So I'll check that and write to the committee on that point.
Thank you. And can I ask about, and it's possibly the wrong word, forgive me if it is, incentives regarding trying to shift a huge culture and the cultural change. So for argument's sake, my understanding is the nearer you are to a hospital, the more likely you are to be admitted. So Northwest Sutherland, many, many miles and hours from a hospital, it has the smallest percentage of people who are admitted to hospital, but it also has the largest challenges. So whether that's collecting, refuse bins or delivering care to older people, are you content that that can be accurately reflected, given what you've said about the relationship you have with local authorities? Particularly when we're talking about integration of health and care, if you like, one cabinet secretary can direct, and another cabinet secretary can't directly intervene.
I think I should correct what. Well, certainly, put some more detail around what I said. The idea that the cabinet secretary for health can say Mrs. McGuffey in Appletaboo should be in Raymore Hospital. I think that would even be a stretch for the health secretary to imagine. But who knows? I don't say that to be. I think there's a very serious point in the issue that Mr. Finney raises, because one of the challenges that we are wrestling with in relation to delayed discharge, for example, is that if I take the area that I represent, there are step down facilities in a number of different towns in the rural areas that I represent. So people who are on a care journey perhaps need a little bit more support, but they don't need to be in Nine Mills Hospital, can come to the Blougowrie Community Hospital, get excellent support, it's near to home, it's easier for everybody, and the rehabilitation is much greater. In some other major urban communities, we perhaps don't have those step-down facilities. And it's a product of the historical development of healthcare services. What we've got to make sure is that we have appropriate support arrangements in place in all different localities. And I think the example that's cited about Northwest Sutherland, there will be different ways of supporting individuals. The way in which health services are delivered will be structured in a fashion that will that essentially it will be an absolutely last resort if somebody has to go to Raigmore Hospital, because it's a long, long way away with a lot of inconvenience to the individual and families. I sometimes wonder whether every, well, I know it's not that wonder, the statistics speak for themselves. Not everybody that's in Nine Wells Hospital in Dundee needs to be in Nine Wells Hospital in Dundee. And the more they're in there and don't need to be there, I come back to my £4,000 a week comparison with my £400 a week comparison. That is, you know, if somebody's in a £4,000 a week bed and they really should be in a £400 a week care arrangement in their own home, you know.
And I suppose the reason we've brought in legislation is to make sure it happens, because we've been encouraging health and local authority to work together on joint plans for quite some time. It's fair to say in some areas they have, and Highland's a good example of that. But the legislation probably speaks for itself. The fact that we've brought it in requires now that joint budget, that joint accountability. And I don't think we can underestimate the change that will bring, because I think it will usher in cultural change. It will require a far sharper focus to shifting that balance, because it's now in everybody's budgetary interest to do so. So there's a bit of carrot and there's a bit of stick. The 173 million, 0.5 million is helping to oil the wheels of change there to help with some of the practical shifting and service redesign and, you know, bridging some of those changes. But without a doubt, I think we have the best opportunity with that sharper focus and joint accountability than we've ever had to see change happen.
Thank you. I think I'm over my allotted time too. I am. Yes, OK.
If you've got one very quick question, I can have a very quick answer, if you don't mind.
Yes,
please.
Indeed. If I may, to Mr. Swinney. Mr. Swinney, last year we asked about tracking third sector payments, third sector funding, and it was about tracking direct payments made to third sector organisations, and there was a plan to publish that. Just, is that progressing at all?
I don't think I've got anything to add to what I said to the convener earlier on about, I think it was the convener about Mr. Johnson, about the way in which we're working with local government to ensure that there's a more cohesive approach to third sector payments. But if there's specific information the committee would like, I'd be very happy to respond to that.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I just confirm, do any other members have any other questions they'd like to ask? No. Can I also thank the Cabinet Secretaries for coming along and for your participation? And that actually concludes the public part of today's meeting. Our next meeting will take place on Thursday, the 4th of December, and I will now suspend the meeting for the committee to move into a private session. Thank you very much. Thank you.